mention of that 18% figure, the estimate of how your tax revenues will grow, Mr. Subramaniam, do you think that Mr. Mukherjee has been a little too optimistic in how much he expects taxation mop-up to grow, because a large part of his entire fiscal calculation is depending on that?
Yes. Yeah. If you look at the numbers which he has arrived at, there seems to be some fallacy or much of an optimism in deriving this kind of a number. Because he says he wants to achieve a 4.5% deficit, and there is a concession on direct taxes of 11,500 crore, and there is an additional indirect tax of 11,200 crore. There is a net only of 200 crore is the loss to the government. If the 200 crore is there, and the tax collections last year was buoyant, so on that assumption he says the tax collections here will be very high. So if at all it is going to happen, the volume of transaction of this should be very high. If the volume of transaction is going to be high, the GDP growth should be much more than the 9% which they have envisaged in that. So therefore, if you derive from the expectation of a 9% growth and a substantial increase of collection, there seems to be some kind of a mismatch there. If at all we are going to have 4.5% growth or 4.5% deficit, it is possible that some more public disinvestment may take place. Now, a debate may arise as to whether disinvestment process can be taken for determining the shortfall or meeting the shortfall in fiscal deficit. That is the debate. But in terms of number, they will be able to achieve 4.5% in case they are able to disinvest something more out of the Navaratna or something. If they do, then there is a possibility of achieving this.
So this disinvestment target, we're again talking about 40,000 crores, I think, for the next year as well. Do you think that's achievable? Also, do you think that perhaps that was one of the reasons that the Steel Authority IPO, for instance, was pushed back into the next year?
I think so. I think it's very difficult because last year we had its target and we were much below target in a very buoyant market. This year the equity markets are not supposed to remain as buoyant as they were last year. We also have a competing performance in the US markets which will attract a lot of capital. So you're not going to find it so easy to do disinvestment. Further, there's another problem, and that problem is the biggest IPOs you want to do are in the oil marketing and oil the ONGC. And these are going to suffer because oil prices are so high and the government has not provided enough in its own sharing which it does with these companies. So I don't know how that investment case pans out for a new investor to look at these companies.
Mm. Okay. So in talking of the markets, Brinda, I want to bring in your experience as a banker to find out the impact on the banking sector. Now, banking being really important simply because of the weightage that it enjoys on the equity markets. Most analysts think that when we do get out of this slight sluggishness and volatility, it's banking that is going to lead that bull run again. What has changed for banking? How does the budget help banking grow another notch?
You know, let's understand one thing. The economy is growing, and as we've all agreed, it'll continue to grow. At least in the next 10 years, we'll see solid growth. How is this growth going to be supported? It's going to be supported by capital mobilized by the banking sector. So that's why banking sector has a very, very important role over here. There are some estimates which say that we will need something like more 2 lakh branches, additional branches, more than 1,60,000 additional ATMs. So you see the huge numbers that will be needed. And if the economy is going to grow at 8, 9, 10%, then you have to have credit growth about 24-25% to support this kind of growth. So for this, you will need to mobilize deposits. You need to get savings, move them out from physical savings into financial savings, mobilize more deposits from the public. So I see the banking system as having a huge role in this whole process. And so for that, very rightly, the finance minister has made some very long-term structural suggestions. He says that I'm going to change the laws that govern. Amit just mentioned that how we are functioning with archaic laws. So these laws need to be changed, and that is going to be looked at. And also a whole lot of finance bills which are pending in parliament. that again he's going to make an effort to push it through. And of course, he's made it a lot more sectors, a lot more growth opportunities and more opportunities for banks to finance across sectors.
Do you think we're going to see those new banking licenses come through in this session or at least this year?
I don't know what the finance minister seems to say that we will see some. But we do need competition, and there is enough room for everybody, private banks, foreign banks, Indian banks. So we do need more banks to come in and support this kind of growth that India needs.
And Amit, do you think corporate borrowing will be able to survive given the kind of government borrowing that they are planning to do? We don't really know the time chart right now. Is it front-ended or back-ended in the fiscal year? But is there enough room for corporates to raise money? There's been a lot of worries about liquidity already.
Well, it's a very strange situation. On one side, the number which he has said, 330,000 crores will be the net borrowing of the government. It's absolutely manageable, much below people's expectation of 400,000 crores. There's no problem there. I think the problem has come up in what was just said, that the deposit growth is not sufficient. And it's not even RBI's repo and reverse repo which has led to this credit squeeze. It's just that 23-24% credit growth is not sustainable by the present size of the banking sector. And therefore, the size of the banking sector needs to expand to pay for various needs of this country. And of course, some of those are wasteful needs, but even the productive needs need capital at a much lower rate. So your question being, will the corporate sector be able to profit and grow if these rates remain so high? The answer is no.
So Brinda, if you want to respond to that, are we expecting another rate hike anytime soon? You know, fixed deposits are back in fashion, simply because of how high the rates have gone. So what is bad for the corporate is very good in my pocket for a change. Are we expecting another rate hike?
It all depends upon inflation. And as everybody has agreed, we'll have to watch that where it goes. And for some time, inflation is going to remain elevated. So I think rates will track inflation.
Okay. Ashima, if I can bring you in on this new plan of directing subsidies in cash form to the ultimate beneficiaries. What's your reading of it?
I think it's a really good move. We should have done this a long time back. You know, something like a negative income tax. And in Brazil, they have this, conditional cash transfers, which has worked wonders. The argument against this is, it's a sort of paternalistic argument, that if you give money to people, they'll blow it up on booze and so on, and they won't actually. So you're assuming that the poor don't know what's good for them. I mean, which is absolutely, but even so, there are ways around it. Like they say, give the money to the woman of the household, because through the world, they've shown that women spend more on children, families, nutrition, rather than drinking. Maybe that's changing, I don't know. But the other thing is, make it, in Brazil, they make the transfer conditional on, say, educating the children or something like that. So you can think of conditional cash transfers. You can tie it to expenditure on food, not just give cash.